This, what is this topic? Mechanical ventilation. Why do we have to talk about mechanical ventilation? Is it important for us to know? Why it is important for us? Why is it important for us? Can somebody speak here? Yes, my cheek is getting bitter. I am giving general anesthesia and you are ventilating them routinely all the time. So you want to have a basic idea about how to do the ventilation. Okay, today what we are going to concentrate is on evolution of mechanical ventilators and basics of mechanical ventilation. That's what we are going to concentrate on. You find every time I talk something about the history. Always. Why is it so? Unless you have an insight into the past, you cannot understand the present and you cannot think about the future. Okay, that is why I just give you an insight into what happened in the past and what's happening now. So your mind will start thinking about the future, what can be done. That is the basic idea. It is not for the exams. Okay, now the objective. Objectives are to give you a brief about the physiology of spontaneous breathing, then negative pressure ventilation, positive pressure ventilation, bag masks, pressure generators, and flow generators. So this is what the objective of this particular lecture. Spontaneous breathing. What happens when you breathe spontaneous? What controls your breathing when you are normally there? What are the factors that controls? I am showing you one picture, please. What controls the breathing? Brain. What is there in the brain that controls? Respiratory center. What are the components of that? Respiratory center contains a pneumatic center comes first, okay, on top. Inspiratory center, expiratory center, and apneistic center. The four centers that are there in the brain, which control. So what does the expiratory center do? What does it do? It sends impulses down. It sends impulses down to the inspiratory muscles. The inspiratory muscles can contract. What are the inspiratory muscles? What are the primary inspiratory muscles? Diaphragm. Okay, what are the other muscles? Intercostals. What intercostal? External intercostal. Okay, what happens when the impulses go down? It produces a negative intraalveolar pressure. When the muscles contract, the diaphragm expands and this one comes out, it produces a negative intraalveolar pressure. So this negative alveolar pressure, when compared to the mouth, then is less than what is there in the atmosphere. And so, and this one, there is a flow from the atmosphere through the airways to the alveolar. That is what we normally do. And when that happens, this flow that happens from the atmosphere into the lung is controlled by, again by the inspiratory center for the time duration in which it is producing the inspiratory muscle activity. So that time controls duration by which the air is going to flow. How does it change over to expiration? There's an inhibitory pathway which goes from the receptors from here and goes into the expiratory center and starts stimulating that, and it finds a balance, and then expiratory muscles start acting. So the inspiration stops and the cycling takes place to expiration. So this is what normally goes on in the brain automatically without your knowledge, without your perceiving that you are doing that, unless you want to perceive it consciously. Yeah, that's what happens. Now when this movement takes place, the flow across the airway is controlled by the resistance that is offered by the airways. That also has a control on the amount of air that can flow from here to here. If this becomes smaller, in spite of having that much of force, the amount of flow will be less. And if the airways are dilated, then the flow will be more. Okay, that is one factor that controls the inspiratory flow into the alveoli. Okay, normally we say the alveolar pressure at the end of expiration is positive because the expiratory muscles have an action, or even the recoil of the lung itself produces a pressure in the alveoli, so it is around plus 2 centimeters of water, and there is a difference between the two of about 5 centimeters of water between inspiration and expiration. Okay, this 5 centimeters of water, what does it do? It produces a tidal ventilation. According to the pressure difference from here to here, and the pressure difference that is produced, and there is a movement of air because of the flow, and then this is the volume that is delivered into the alveoli. What controls this particular volume that is being going into the alveoli? You have something called a complex. And this complex has got two components. One is the chest wall complex, other one is the lung complex. Lung complex depends on the elasticity. Chest wall complex depends on the position of the chest wall at the end of expiration. That is what and about the movement of the bones and the relaxation of the ligaments and other things. That's what determines what is the normal position of the chest wall. In mid position of the chest wall, what happens? It is in mid position, so it is already producing some amount of negative pressure. The amount it can expand, the amount it can allow, that's what determines the complex of the chest wall. Okay, and this, normally this complex is measured as, it has an influence on both the pressure range and the tidal volume that can be delivered, and the normal complex is calculated as 100 ml per centimeter. Okay, so that 0.1 liter per centimeter. So if there is a pressure difference of about 5, and how much of the volume that will be delivered will be about 500 ml. That is the normal tidal breath that we have, 500 ml of tidal exchange by the activity of the muscles. And then we breathe at a particular rate. Again, that is controlled by the brain. And if we take that, we breathe at a rate of 12, then we have this, multiply 500 by 12, then we have minute ventilation, which is 6 liters. And this 6 liters, we expect at least 4 liters to be the alveolar ventilation, because 1/3 of the ventilation goes into the airways, 50 ml, and remaining 350 ml is alveolar ventilation. And so the normal alveolar ventilation is 4 liters. Why we are talking about this number of 4 liters? We have already talked about this 4 liters some time back. What is the importance of this 4 liters? No? Yeah? Little loudly and confidently tell whatever you want to tell. Nobody is going to kill you. Yeah. Well, Nadi, circulation. We are talking about the air exchange, alveolar ventilation of 4 liters. Why do you, what did we talk about 4 liters of alveolar ventilation? In relation to what? In relation to what? Answer comes from there. We said normally we produce 200 ml of carbon dioxide that needs to go out, and if it has to go out as a 5% mixture, because whatever comes out is a 5% mixture, and if it has to, 200 ml has to come out as a 5% mixture, then you need 4 liters of alveolar ventilation. So that 200 ml will be eliminated. Remember, the idea of ventilation is to remove carbon dioxide. The basic thing. The ventilation is to remove the carbon dioxide. Oxygenation depends on so many other things. But removal of carbon dioxide depends predominantly on ventilation and movement of air in and out of the lung. Otherwise, it cannot come out. Okay. Now, this is a... Then, you have expiratory muscle. The recoil, how does the cyclic take place? from inspiration to expiration. He said, how does the cycling take place? He said, there's an inhibitory pathway which goes and blocks, and then the inspiratory muscles stop. And so the exhalation takes place predominantly by collapsing of the lung by itself, and the expiratory muscle to some extent, and the diaphragm comes back to its position. So at that time, what happens? The alveolar pressure becomes slightly positive, and then because it is positive, the air has to move out from here. It has to go out of it, and so you have a movement. Because small pressure is atmospheric, that is zero, here it is positive, so there is a passive movement, and that movement through the airways goes out and the expiratory flow. And again, this airway resistance plays a part in the amount of air that goes out. If the patient is an asthmatic, what happens? Yeah, if the patient is asthmatic, what happens? There is an increased airway resistance. So what happens to expiration? It's prolonged. Expiration is prolonged. And if you don't allow adequate expiratory time, then there will be carbon dioxide accumulation. Okay, that's the basic spontaneous breathing. And this is a famous butterfly diagram that is proposed by Dr. Mushin way back 1965, and people have seen it and people have forgotten about it. I suppose I am the only person who is still insisting on explaining things using this particular diagram, because it is simple to understand, simple to explain. Okay. Now, going back to the history, way back in 1670, demonstrated, then this is John Mayo, air drawn into the lungs by expanding the thoracic cavity. He demonstrated that. And in 1832, John Dalziel, he wrote a book on sleep and an apparatus for promoting artificial respiration. Way back in 1832, he talked about apparatus for artificial ventilation. But later, in 1881, Alexander Graham Bell, what is he famous for? Known for? Telephone. Yeah, he is also a person who thinks about a lot of things, because at that particular time everybody thinks about everything, not about one small thing. Okay. Now in 1881, his son, 1 day old son, died after birth. Then he thought he has died because he is not able to make an air exchange. What can be done? Improve that so that these people will survive. So he made a sketch, and he made a sketch like this to say that if you enclose the chest like this and then produce a negative pressure inside that, the chest can expand. And so this has been recorded way back in 1881. And action on this, construction on this, all this took a little longer time. And it is not by him, it is by somebody else. Based on this, Philip Trinka, who experimented with the cats. He put it inside a cage, the cat is there, only the head is outside. And he used a 100 ml syringe and pushed in 100 ml of air, withdrew 100 ml of air with Mickey. Then he found that he could make this cat, keep this cat alive for a period of time by repeating this. Pushing 100 ml of air inside a cage that is airtight, and then withdrawing 100 ml of air. What does it do? When you push it inside, it compresses the chest. When you draw it out, it allows the chest to expand. Okay, so that is how he was able to record a movement of air in and out of the cat's mouth, movement of air, and the cat was kept alive for a period of time. So he was convinced that this could be done. People who are not able to breathe can be kept alive. So, and 8 years, and this is the first iron lung in which human being was kept inside. It's an 8-year-old girl ventilated for several days using this same technology, only using a motor for producing movement of air. And so that, but later she died of pneumonia. Okay. Now this is the first Trinka's iron lung. He He formulated this, he designed it, and then he made it iron lung, and then where the head is outside, rest of the body is inside. And then you have two holes by which the nurses can do some nursing care for the patient. So this is how, and the motor at the bottom, this is how the first ventilator, negative pressure ventilator was designed. That's way back in 1937. And that was quite expensive to design. It did not come into common use. So this is both, he was an Australian engineer. He made this particular model, which he could make it a little cheaper, and then it could be made mass production, so that many people could be assisted by this particular device. So because it is cheap and it found a place, and then the equipment was put in all the hospitals for treating patients who have a paralysis of the thoracic muscles. And this is a Coventry alligator escalator. This is much further later, they designed it so that it is much more comfortable for the patient to sit. It opens up and then you clip it inside, not pull and push, not that way, but you just open it up, and then you have the tank and the motor here, which will cycle. And this, you find this respiratory unit of Southwestern Hospital in London. So you have all the ventilators inside, and the patients are treated here. The alligator iron lung. It's called alligator because it opens up like an alligator, and then it can close it. So it is called the alligator cabinet respirator. Now this is again redesigning by the German. That's during the World War, Second World War. They made it much more posh looking, and then more easy to clean, keep it clean and all that. So that is the one that you find. That's a ventilator. And this is the first QLS ventilator, which more simplified this and had a cage only. Just why should the whole patient be inside a cabinet? If we can enclose only the chest and then produce the same pressure changes, the patient should be able to breathe satisfactorily. So they designed this, the QLS ventilator, which is supplied onto the chest, and then they could be ventilated. That is in 1952-53 the time. Now, this interesting story of John Postwich. He lived 50 years with this ventilator. He was the merchant navy in 1950. He was in the ship when he got ill. He was suffering from that illness for about 4 or 5 days before the ship could reach a land. And then he lost consciousness, and he was transported to the hospital, diagnosed as polio. Bulbar polio, where he cannot breathe, and he was put on a iron lung. This is the iron lung alligator ventilator that he was put on. And he was kept alive. And then this is in 1959 when who's that visiting? Remember, can you recognize? Prince of Wales visited him in the hospital. Okay, now, the nurse who was looking after him in the hospital was called Maggie. She looked after him right from that time till 1971, and they got married. She married him because 16 years she had been looking after him all the time on the ventilator. And she married him, and then he was put on the QLS ventilator. Then he was sent home after 16 years inside a cage, inside a hospital. He went home, he bought a house, and then he went home. And she went along with him, and she lived with him. And this is in 1990. He's on QLS ventilator at home, and they had a motorized cot, which can be a cot and a chair, and which he could operate himself by his. So there's a contraption here in which he could talk, and then he could make the things happen, either sitting position or moving, to move anywhere he wants. So after so many years, he had some liberty to move around by his self because of advancement in the technology. And this is in 2002, where he is there in a sitting position. Okay, all this is interesting. And this is in 2003, he was hospitalized in St. Thomas Hospital, London, treated for chest infection. Using the same ventilator, same type of ventilator, alligator ventilator, they did not give him, put in a tube into the throat, then infect and make much more damage. They treated him with the same thing. And he died in 2006 at the age of 67 because of the uncontrolled respiratory infection. So he lived for 50 years with this type of ventilation. That's a big story about John Christus. Then I said he was affected by the polio. Then that is in 1952 in Copenhagen. There were 1 million people and then 3,000 cases were affected, were identified. Paralytic was 1,250. This is something like what's happening now with the coronavirus. 3,000 people have died. Identified as more than 85,000 have been identified as being infected. So similar to that, 1,250 were paralyzed and respiratory insufficiency was 345 patients. And then they employed the positive pressure ventilation because they didn't have so many ventilators, so the negative pressure ventilator. So they did a tracheostomy, and then they put in a tube, and then they used this. Can you identify this? What is that? Water to unflow canister, giving oxygen and ventilating through that. And who were the people who were ventilating? This is a medical students. They are put on shift for 6 hours. Everybody will come. Then they will do a 6 hour shift and ventilating them for a period of time. Like this, they kept them alive for days until they recovered. Almost 50% of them recovered, but 50% of them succumbed. But that is the time. So victims are for days together that record survival. And that is, they thought we are giving 100% oxygen, we are depending on the flow of oxygen all the time, and because this reservoir bag has to fill with the oxygen for you to ventilate. And though you are absorbing carbon dioxide, it needs to be changed every time, 2-3 hours it has to be changed. So they thought we should have something better than this. So the necessity becomes mother of invention. So we had self-inflating bag. That time it was made by, it was commonly called as an ambu bag. So any other expansion for ambu people know? That is a misnomer. Please don't say that, because somebody who thought, no, I should give an expansion for that, put something. But ambu indicates only the trademark of the company which is produced. That is all it is. Artificial manual breathing unit, all that is made up by people who came later. They said, no, this should be expanded. But there's no expansion like that. You can confidently say, if anybody asks you, there's no expansion. It is a name, trademark of the company. And only the bag that was produced by that company need to be called as ambu bag. And all others are not. But commonly we use the term ambu bag, because that is the first one that came inside that company. And so what is this? How do you call this? How will you call this bag? What you normally use here? What will you call them? Self-inflating bag. Okay, self-inflating bag. So they produced the self-inflating bag, and then they started using this for ventilating patients and kept them alive by using atmospheric air right through. How is this constructed? What are the requirements if you have to use this bag for ventilating a person? What are the requirements that have to go into this to function satisfactorily? Oxygen is not for ventilation. Please remember, we are using an atmospheric air. Oxygen is not a must. Oxygen is if you have to oxygenate somebody. Ventilation is not part of oxygenation. What are the requirements of this construction of this bag? Well, when you squeeze the bag, what should happen? The air should go inside from the bag into the patient's lung. When it should not go out of the bag in any other place. What is the other place that it can go out? Okay, that is one. When you squeeze the bag, the air should go from the bag to the patient. The movement should be in that direction. When you leave the bag open, then the air has to go out from the lung into the atmosphere. But how does the bag get filled up? When you leave the bag, the air from the patient's lung goes into the atmosphere. How does the bag get filled? How? It gets filled up from the atmospheric air. When you squeeze, the atmospheric air doesn't go into the atmosphere, it goes into the lung. But when you leave it, the atmospheric air has to get inside. So what are the requirements that you need for this to function satisfactorily? Simple man, you said you need a valve at the front, which doesn't allow. And you need another valve at the back, which doesn't allow the gas to go out. So that it closes, this one closes, this valve closes, this valve opens, and then the air flows into the patient. And then when you leave it out, this valve will close. It will not allow the air to go back to the back. This valve should open. The atmospheric air should go into the bag, and whatever the patient breathes out should get out to the atmosphere. So what do you need? You need three valves, not two. You need three. Don't you need three? Two. Come to consensus. You need two valves or three valves? Three valves. What are these valves? So you need an air intake valve. That is here at the back of the bag, and then you have a unidirectional valve, that's a respiratory valve that allows the gas to go inside, and then it closes, and then the gas goes out. This is the expiratory valve. If the patient takes a breath spontaneously also, this valve will not allow the atmospheric air to go inside in this direction, but it will allow only from that direction. What is this valve commonly referred to as? Fish mouth valve. Why is it called fish mouth? Opens like a fish. Good. So you know the requirement of a ventilator. If you are going to use a unit for ventilating, you need three valves to control the flow. One is to allow unidirectional flow, one from the source into the bag, from the bag into the lung, from the lung into the atmosphere. So that is the basic construction of any ventilator. Any ventilator, this is the basic construction. Now, then we had this Oxford inflating bellows at the same time. This is being used in anesthesia. You have a valve here and a valve here. So this will allow the gas to come here, go to the bag. When you push, it will allow it to go back to the patient. So this is one valve, this is another valve. And then you had a magnet here, which you put on top of this. This valve will get pulled up and then it will remain incompetent. So that the patient can breathe satisfactorily by taking atmosphere. Okay, that is how this was designed. This is called Oxford inflating bellows. You pull and push, not squeeze like this. You will be pulling the bellows, concertina bellows up like this, and then pushing it like that. So that is the movement that is to do for ventilating the patient. Okay. Now, based on this same principle, we had another ventilator that was produced that is called Oxford East Radcliffe ventilator. What does it do? It does got the same concertina bag. Instead of this action being manually done by person, this is automated by having a motor and having a pulley. So when it is pulled up, this will be pulled up mechanically by a mechanism of the motor. And so there is an air intake valve on this side, and this is the expiration. And after it is being pulled up, the bellows get filled up with the atmospheric air, and then the pulling force is stopped. And then because you have kept a weight on top of this bellows, that weight will press the bellows down, so the air will move them then back to the patient. Instead of doing it mechanically, when you do, you are pulling it out, you are pushing it inside. So you are doing a mechanical movement and the force. Here that has been replaced by keeping a weight on top, then allowing the same thing, this to be pulled up mechanically by the machine. So that is a very simple ventilator for ventilating a person with the atmospheric air automatically. you find that during the marriage, John was ventilated with this particular ventilator. He's exactly ventilator. You see that it is here. He's breathing through that. Okay. Telling you some stories. Now, normally, what happens when there is ventilation? Normal alveoli. You apply a positive pressure on the mouth, say, on this place. Say, let's 15 centimeters of water. Positive pressure, only you can have a bag or whatever mechanism. You are applying a positive pressure. So that positive pressure allows the air to go inside and expand the lung, because there is a pressure difference between from the atmosphere to the alveoli, and that pressure difference makes it. So you find, I just want you to concentrate on this part of it when this is happening. Because the mouth pressure is there, the pressure is maintained all through time, and the pressure difference, alveolar pressure, keeps increasing as time goes on, so that this pressure and the mouth pressure become equal. When this is equal, when that is happening, the pressure difference between the mouth and the alveoli comes down. Because this is increasing, the difference between the two comes down, that is the graph, and a flow takes place. Initially, the flow is very high, and then the flow comes down because the pressure difference comes down between the two places. Because this comes down, the flow also comes down and becomes zero when the pressure difference becomes zero between alveoli and mouth. So you have a descending flow ramp that is reduced when you normally breathe. The flow becomes maximum and then it comes down, comes to zero. You understand that? This is what normally happens. This is what is called a flow generator. It's called pressure generator. And when the compliance is low, what happens when the compliance is low? The same 15 centimeters of water, when the ventilation takes place, because the compliance is less, the pressure equals to the mouth pressure much faster. It equals much faster, and then the pressure comes, so the flow comes down much faster, so the volume that is delivered becomes less. When the compliance is less, when you use this kind of a ventilator with the constant pressure generation, the volume delivery becomes less, because it doesn't expand sufficiently to accommodate the air. It reaches the pressure much faster, so the volume comes. Okay, so these are called the pressure generator, because you are create, what's the common pressure generator that you use? All of you are using a pressure generator at the end of the test. Which is the commonest one that you are using? APL valve. I'm saying pressure generator. Pressure generator means, what I mean is that you are generating this pressure. Huh? Yeah? Bag ventilation. Yeah, you are manually ventilating with the reservoir bag, circuit connected to the patient, and you apply the pressure on the bag, and you are trying to keep the pressure constant. You are keeping that pressure constant, so that the pressure difference is there between the bag and the alveoli, there's a movement of air from the bag onto the patient's lung. And if the complaint becomes less, you apply a lot more pressure, deliver the same amount of gases, the compliance is good, applied pressure is much less. So it's a constant pressure generator, and you are trying to keep it constant by applying a constant pressure, but it is not possible for you to apply the same pressure on the bag all the time squeezing. It is likely to vary, that is why the manual ventilation is not uniform. Okay. Now, so if you have to deliver a constant volume the person, in spite of variation in the complex, how can you achieve that? That is when we had the concept of flow generators. Here what you've done is that you have a gas at a very high pressure. Your pipeline pressure is what? What's the pipeline pressure? You have the pipeline running all over the hospital, no? to your machine. What is the pipeline pressure? 55 psi. And 1 psi is equal to how much? How many psi make 1 atmosphere? 1 of you use vehicles. Use a car. How much pressure do you put in your tires? So you go there, that fellow put something, you come up. How much do you fill it up? 32 psi. Convert it into kilograms. Convert it into pascals. How much is 1 atmosphere? PSI. How much in kilograms? 14.8 psi. Okay, 1 atmosphere is equal to how many centimeters of water? How many millimeters per cubic? 760 millimeters per cubic. When you convert it into centimeters of water, thousand centimeters of water. Good guess. Thousand centimeters of water, that is what is 1 atmosphere. And what we are talking about is the pipeline which supplies you with the pressure of 4 atmospheres. You are having it at 60 psi, 55 to 60 psi. 4 atmospheres. So that is the pressure at which the gas is supplied level. And you put a valve in between so that you can open that valve intermittently and allow the flow to take place. Okay, and you control the time during for which the valve is kept open, and then you close it again. So what happens when you do this? Okay. So what happens is, here you see that you control it to some extent and you have it at 600, and then the mouth pressure here is at 600 when it is open, and so the alveolar pressure keeps going up. When the pressure goes up, and you control the time so that the cycling takes place, and this stops according to, and because of the pressure difference between the two, there is that movement of air that the flow takes place, and then you find this comes down from 600 to 585 only, so not much of a difference between the two, so this flow remains almost constant. So we call this a constant flow generator. When you use a pressure generator, the pressure equalization takes place very fast when the flow comes down. So you have a descending flow generator, because it's a constant pressure generator work as decelerating flow. And whereas the constant flow generators work as, they give a constant flow, then you have to control it, the time. Mechanism for controlling the time. That's what the happen, and then you open the expiratory valve so that the patient breathes out to the atmosphere. This is what normally happens when you connect them to mechanical ventilators. Okay, so what are the flow generators that were there available at that time? One is Siemens 900, I don't know, seen all this, and this is electronically controlled, this is pneumatically controlled. World market. It's totally pneumatically controlled, and this one is totally electronically controlled. Here you have the three valves that we talked about, which controls, opens and allows the back to fill up, the back compresses, goes into the patient, and the patient breathes out and comes out through another valve and goes into the atmosphere. Okay, so that is how this is controlled. This one is totally pneumatically controlled. Pneumatic controls are controlled by the flow of gas through an orifice, and this based on a fluidic principle in which the constant feedback by flow of gas takes place for moving the valves. So the timing is controlled by the movement supplying some amount of gases to control the valves. Okay, that is totally pneumatic. And this is another ventilator that came in. At that time it is called Engstrom Erika. What you use here now is CAS 300 ventilators. Use the ICU. Which one is this? AC. Now that's the AC. Okay. So this is the volume control ventilator, and based on this only you have this. Which, what's the name of this ventilator? By GE that we are using in the ICU. We will. GE, huh? Cascade, or Catalina. Okay, not seen. That has been put, where is it being used? Cardiothoracic ICU, in the NICU. Now, you people should have an exposure to all these ventilators and should be familiar with these ventilators and functioning of these ventilators. It is most important because anesthesiologist is supposed to be the masters in handling them. If you don't have, who all have gone to the ICU so far? Worked in the ICU? You have gone? Who else has gone? You are not gone? People are not gone to ICU? Have you people looked at the ventilator functioning and how it is? And what ventilator do we use now in the ICU? What's the ventilator that you are using in the ICU? MACPET. T is silent. So, how do you pronounce it? MACPET. Servo I, what is the model? Okay, you should know and how it functions, how to control it, all that you should know. That is why I am just trying to give you the basics of how to do the ventilation. Now, modern ventilators can be used as both pressure generator for pressure based breaths as well as used as a flow generator for volume based breaths. And it can be used as a combined pressure and flow generator for combined breaths. And can you understand what is this pressure-based breath and volume-based breath and combined pressure? You have used it on a ventilator. We'll discuss it a little later. Okay, how do you define a mechanical breath? How do you control the breath that you are going to deliver? How many knobs do you usually use for controlling the breath? Okay, let me go because time is getting over. Okay, you find the basic thing that you want during the ventilation. What's the basic thing that you need? You need to produce an alveolar ventilation of 4 liters. That is what you want. Or you want to have a ventilation, alveolar ventilation satisfactory to remove the carbon dioxide so normocardia can be maintained in the blood. You want a PaCO2 between 35 and 40 when you do the ventilation. So for that. So what you need is, basic need is to produce ventilation, so you can equate it to alveolar ventilation. Now I am going to equate it to minute ventilation because that is what we see, that is what we can measure. So you need to produce a minute ventilation that is satisfactory. You find that one is a tidal volume, other one is frequency. Multiplication of this frequency and tidal volume gives the minute volume. Okay, if you change one, say if you say I set a minute ventilation and the frequency, automatically the tidal volume will be fixed. If I set on the ventilator, if I set the minute ventilation 6 liters and the frequency of 12, automatically the tidal volume will get fixed. That's 500 ml. So if you, these are the basic 3 things you have to set them. Any 2 knobs you set, it is enough to control the third one. So anything that I show you in a triangle, they have an influence on each other. That's what you remember. Okay, so if you set the minute ventilation frequency, tidal volume will be fixed. If you set the minute ventilation and the tidal volume, frequency will get fixed automatically. So you will be setting only 2 parameters of this 3 that are there that you have control. Now you see that tidal volume. What is this tidal volume? We said by inspiratory muscles, we produce a flow from the atmosphere into the lung, and then there is a time duration for which the flow is taking place. So if you have a peak flow and then you have time fixed on that, then you automatically set the tidal ventilation. If you have 30 liters of peak flow and then you are setting it for 1 second, doing it for 1 second, then what happens to the tidal volume? Automatically 500 ml of tidal volume is delivered to the patient because you have set a flow and a time. During that time, that much volume is so you can control setting this tidal ventilation by setting these 2, inspiratory flow and time. So what you have this, and then you have this for setting this. So then you have one more control. You see, you have a frequency. What is frequency? If you say frequency of 12, then let's say frequency of 10 for easy calculation. Frequency of 10. What is the total duration of one cycle? 6 seconds. 6 seconds. And that is the total time. And then this time is divided into expiratory time and expiratory time. And this, and so you have a ratio. Inspiratory, expiratory ratio. So if you set this inspiratory, expiratory ratio, then these two things get set automatically. Or if you set this one, then also this gets automatically. Same way, if you set this and the total time, frequency and the inspiratory time, all these things get set by itself. You along with me, all of you? Okay. Now, if you look at it, all the controls that you have talked about, you have about 8 controls. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 control knobs, but you have to set only 3 of these control knobs to control a breath. Of this 8, any ventilator you go, you will find 3 knobs which might be different. It will not be the same. It might be different. One might have inspiratory flow, one might have minute ventilation, one might have volume setting, one might have IU ratio or TI. So you will have to decipher on the ventilator what knobs that you have that you will have to control, and what is the interplay of those controls to other parameters that you want to set. That is what you have to understand, to understand how the machine is functioning. Okay. So maximum 3 knobs only will be there for setting. So you could either set this, this, and this one of it here, this, this, and one of it here, this, and then this, and one of it here. So it will be a combination of all these things. So but you will be handling only 3 knobs. And you have to understand what it is. Inspiratory time, total time, inspiratory flow, tidal volume, frequency, or minute ventilation. What is it that is? What is it that you set in your ventilator? No, Mac A, servo I, what do you set? Tidal volume, frequency, inspiratory time. Okay, you are setting it as inspiratory time or you are setting it as IU ratio? Is there a facility for it to change into inspiratory time? Is there a facility for changing it into inspiratory time? What do you set in the pressure-based ventilation? You set your peak pressure, you set your inspiratory time, set your inspiratory time, and then you set your frequency. No? I know, no, none of you have looked into the ventilator settings and functions. All of you have just gone there and looked at the patient. Now, apart from that, there might be another control which says plateau pressure. Means if you want to give an inspiratory pass so that the gas distribution is satisfactory, then you might have a control called plateau pressure, plateau time, for the duration for which the inspiration will be held so that the pressure is maintained constant for allowing for satisfactory exchange of gases. Okay, so that will get added up to inspiratory time. This is what you need for eliminating carbon dioxide. For oxygenation, you will have to set differently. You need to set the percentage of oxygen. You need to set a peep so that's what controls the diffusion across the membranes. And these are the two things you need for oxygenating. Without this, if the patient is breathing spontaneously, satisfactorily, this is what you need to oxygenate. You are not ventilating a patient for oxygenation. Even on a ventilator, you will have to set these things so that oxygenation is satisfied. Okay. How do you treat a pulmonary edema? Paralyze, put on the ventilator and ventilate. Is that so? Yeah? Non-invasive ventilation. Who said that? Yeah. Come, how do you do that? Yeah, you allow the patient to breathe spontaneously and you are facilitating the movement of air into the lung so that he doesn't struggle, and you are fixing up the FiO2, and then you are fixing up the beam so that transfer of gases can take place satisfactorily across the alveolar membrane for oxygenation. And also, in the meantime, you treat to take out the fluid from the lung so that the patient becomes better. So doing non-invasive ventilation, what you predominantly set is predominantly set the pressure that you are trying to apply onto the alveoli when he is breathing spontaneous. Okay. So another thing you might set is a trigger. If the patient is breathing spontaneously, he has to synchronize with the machine so that you set up a control called trigger by which the patient can synchronize with the machine. So these are the three things we set for oxygenating and synchronizing with the machine. This is what you set for eliminating carbon dioxide from the lung. Okay. That's the normal thing that the positive pressure you have. What are these waveforms that you normally see? First is the flow waveform. Depending on what kind of a ventilator that you're using, what kind of setting you give, it could be a constant flow generator, or it could be a pressure generator. And this is the pressure waveform that you see, and then this is the volume waveform that you see. Normally, these are the three waveforms that you see, and you should be able to interpret these waveforms when you look at them on the ventilator to see whether the machine is functioning satisfactorily and to see whether the patient is getting ventilated successfully. Is there any dyssynchrony, is there any problem between the two, and am I doing the right thing to decipher? That is why these displays are given on the ventilator. Additional about 2 lakhs for buying these display of these waveforms. It is not for fashion. So, see, whole thing is looking nice. Showing all that. It is meant for making diagnosis based on the waveform patterns and to make sure that the machine is functioning and the patient is being ventilated satisfactorily. Now, you said you will have to change from one phase to another phase. Automatically, when the inspiration ends, the expiration starts. That will be controlled by the brain. How do you control the machine for this changeover? That is called cycling. Okay, how do you go? So you have the phases of ventilation, inspiratory phase, change from inspiration to expiration. Then you have expiratory phase, change over from expiration to expiration. These are the phases, and then you have the types of cycling. And inspiratory phase, the machine can function either as a flow generator, or as a pressure generator, or as a volume generator. All these terminologies are given to say how the machine functions during the inspiratory phase. We talked about the pressure generator, we talked about the flow generator, and if you set a volume and say this is what I want to be delivered to the patient, then it becomes a volume generator. Irrespective of all other things, the machine will deliver that much of volume. Okay. Now, the cycling that takes place, how does this change over from inspiration to expiration? That can be defined as it is volume cycling. When that much of volume has been set delivered, then it measures that, cycles off to expiration. So that is called a volume cycling. And it could be time cycling. You are fixing a time, an inspiratory time, this much is my inspiratory time. So once the time is over, it switches off to expiration. So you are controlling that time. It could be pressure cycling. When you say when this pressure is reached, cycle off. The expiration. Okay, that is called pressure cycling. And flow cycling, you give a command to say when the flow comes to this level, you cycle out to other phase, expiratory or respiratory. So that is called flow cycling. So these are the terminologies that are used to describe cycling, and those are the terminologies used to describe the phase, excretory phase, or the excretory phase. Okay. So now, so depending on the combination of that, you might have volume preset, volume cycling ventilators. You might have volume preset, time cycling ventilators. You might have pressure controlled time cycling ventilators. You might have pressure limited time cycling ventilators. You might have pressure preset, pressure cycling ventilators. So the combination of this, you have to understand the ventilator that you are using, how it is functioning in the phase, respiratory phase, and how it is cycling off to the expiration. So you will have satisfactory control of what you will have to do to have its proper respiratory cycling. And on the expiratory phase, most of the ventilators work as atmospheric pressure generator. That means they leave it open to atmosphere, there is a pressure in the lung, the atmospheric pressure is well. So the flow takes place. That is what it is. And there could be positive pressure generators or negative pressure generators during the expiration. That is, if you apply a PP, then it becomes a positive pressure generator during the expiratory phase. It doesn't allow the pressure to fall below that particular pressure. So it is, and it is actively done. And the negative pressure generator, it might pull out the gases from the lung by applying a negative pressure, like applying a suction. But commonly, most ventilators function as atmospheric pressure generators and with a peak where it is a positive pressure. And the cycling from expiration to inspiration, how does that cycling take place? It could be time cycle, you set a time, after this time I want the next inspiration to go. That means you set a frequency and you set the inspiratory time. So remaining is the inspiratory time. Once that time is over, we have set 6 seconds. After 6 seconds, automatically it goes into inspiration again. That is how cycling takes place. It could be patient cycling if you allow the patient to trigger the ventilator. So the rate will be set by the patient and the patient will trigger the ventilator. Okay, it could be pressure triggered or flow triggered. What do you mean by pressure trigger? It senses the patient makes an attempt so that the pressure in the circuit drops. If you say, if the pressure drops by 2 centimeters of water, you cycle off to inspiration so that volume is delivered to the patient. Okay, that is what is pressure cycling, pressure triggering. A flow triggering, when the patient, it monitors the flow in the circuit, there's a constant flow that is being given, it monitors, and if the flow drops by about 1 liter, 2 liters, you set that. So if the flow drops, why does the flow drop? Because the patient tries to take a breath, and so the flow from the ventilator goes to the patient, and then what is monitored on the expiratory side? Flow is monitored on the expiratory side. So that flow drops, and then it starts cycling to inspiration to allow more flow to go to the patient. So these are the triggering mechanisms. Patient side, patient side. Okay, this will be relevant to you because you are not going to see this ventilator, because between 70s and then till 2000, we had a lot of ventilators which are coming with different controls, different way of controlling them. They are still there, but most hospitals have got stuck to one type of ventilator, so there is a uniformity in ventilating them, people understanding what is being done. That is why, though we had 4 different types of ventilators when I was here, so that you people will understand the mechanisms of different ventilators. All that have been taken off, you are stuck with one ventilator, only one type of ventilator, and you are not seeing the different types. So, but when you go out from here, you will see different types and you will be at a loss what the hell I am seeing. That is why I am telling you about the basics. This is the example of a Siemens 900 ventilator, which is a volume controlled time cycle, in which you set the minute ventilation, you set the frequency, and then you set the inspiratory time. And you might set the plateau time. So that is part of the inspiratory. So these are the 3 knobs that will be used for setting this particular. But this ventilator has been replaced. Same company is what is producing this MAC-A servo now. Okay. Now you have the Puritan Bennett ventilators, where it is a tidal volume. You set the total amount of tidal volume, then you set the expiratory time, then you set the frequency, so that, and of course the plateau time if you want the plateau time. So these are the 3 controls you will be using it, feel it and benefit later. Have you seen? People have seen. Do we have it in our hospital? Yes, we have it in our hospital. Galileo is another company which is coming in. There you set again the tidal volume, and then IU ratio, not the infinity time, IU ratio and the frequency, then you set the blood to time. That is Hamilton ventilators, that is Galileo. Then you have the Dragger ventilator, where you set the tidal volume, inspiratory flow and IU ratio. It's volume control, that's a limited time cycle. So this terminology comes based on what you are setting and what you are controlling. That is how this whole thing goes. Okay. So we broadly classified the pressure-based mode, volume-based mode and combined mode of ventilation. How you control these phases, respiratory phase, cycling, and what's the basis of spontaneous breathing and how it has got transformed into the positive pressure ventilator that we use. The negative pressure ventilator, positive pressure ventilator. Thank you. Why negative pressure ventilation went out of vogue? Because if you have to remove secretions, and if you enclose the whole body, we say the main way that you can remove secretions is by postural drainage. Now, when the whole body is encased inside a ventilator, how do you do a postural drainage satisfactorily? That is not possible. So that is why the patient has to cough. If the patient has to cough effectively, then they have to generate a lot more pressure and then cough. So the psi mechanisms were introduced so that you take a larger volume and then try to push it out. But again, it is not a comfortable one for the patient too. Well, you see now that any patient who is on a ventilator, you just put a tube and start pumping and you keep them alive. That it is not possible when you do it with the negative pressure. And the ease with which you can do that ventilation has made us change from negative to positive. Remember, whenever you do a positive pressure ventilation, you are altering the physiology of the person. Negative pressure ventilation, you are maintaining the same physiology, but the moment you start positive pressure ventilation, changing the physiology. So your target should be how fast I can bring the physiology back to normal. That means when, how fast I can wean the patient off the ventilator. That should be your target when you put them on it.